Well, good morning and welcome, everyone. It is really great to see you. And I can actually see all of you on the basis that we're on Zoom today, as opposed to our usual YouTube. So it is really great to be able to see you and to help us to all participate and enjoy the service in a more obvious way together. So really, really great to see you, and welcome to our Good Friday service at Coley Park Baptist Church. Let me pray in a minute, and we'll go from there. But if, as I said, you are able to just ensure you're on mute, that would be great. Let me pray as we start our Good Friday service. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the fact that we are able to meet this Good Friday, that we don't have restrictions that some of our brothers and sisters around the world face. We may well face restrictions in the sense that we cannot be together physically, and yet we are together. We are one body. We may well be made up of many different parts. We may well be in different places, but we are one body worshipping the one Lord Jesus Christ, who died as we remember today, but who, more importantly, as we'll remember on Sunday, has risen and is reigning in heaven and on earth. So, Father, help us as we go through our service today to remember that. Help us to reflect on those events over 2,000 years ago at Calvary. But help us to remember that this isn't the end of the story, that it is just a pivotal point to something much more glorious and everlasting. For we ask in your name. Amen. So just to explain the format as we go through our service today, we'll be remembering the events of Good Friday, as you would expect. And there are going to be a series of readings and songs interspersed in a similar way to we do sometimes carols before Christmas. So we have readings and songs interspersed. There aren't going to be introductions between the readings and the songs. They're just going to flow seamlessly. And so please do bear that in mind. We also have communion as well. We're going to hear the readings, and then Steve is going to preach. And then after Steve has preached, we're then going to have a time of communion. So again, if you haven't come prepared with your own bread and juice or wine, then please do ensure that after Steve's service and after a sermon and after we've had that song, that you then have a cup and bread ready for joining in communion together. Let me start, though, before we have our first song, by reading from Mark's Gospel, when Jesus predicts what was going to happen on Good Friday and then Easter Sunday. So let me read. It's Mark chapter 10, and just a couple of verses 32 to 34. And then we're going to go into our first song, which is Jesus is Lord, the cry that echoes through the nations. So Mark chapter 10 and verse 32, Jesus says this. Jesus and his disciples were on their way up to Jerusalem, with Jesus leading the way. And the disciples were astonished, while those who followed were afraid. Again, he took the 12 aside and told them what was going to happen to him. "We are going up to Jerusalem," he said, "and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him and kill him. But 3 days later, he will rise." Let's sing together, "Jesus is Lord."
Thank you. Good morning, my lovely church family. It's Teresa here. Oh, you can see me now. Yeah, it's Teresa here. Our first reading today is Mark chapter 14, verses 43 to 65. Jesus arrested. Just as he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, appeared. With him was a crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders. Now, the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. The men seized Jesus and arrested him. Then one of those standing near drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Am I leading a rebellion," said Jesus, "that you have to come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I was with you, teaching in the temple courts, and you did not arrest me. But the scriptures must be fulfilled." Then everyone deserted him and fled. A young man wearing nothing but a linen garment was following Jesus. When they seized him, he fled naked, leaving his garment behind. Then they took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, elders, and teachers of the law came together. Peter followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest. There he sat with the guards and warmed himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death, but they did not find any. Many tested him, but their statements did not agree. Then some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this man-made temple, and in 3 days will build another, not made by man.'" Yet even then their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, "Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you?" But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?" "I am," said Jesus, "and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." The high priest tore his clothes. "Why do we need any more witnesses?" he asked. "You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" They all condemned him as worthy of death. Then some began to spit at him. They blindfolded him, struck him with their fists, and said, "Prophecy." And the guards took him and beat him.
Come and see, come and see, come and see the King of Love. See the purple robe and crown of thorns he wears. Soldiers mock, rulers sneer, as he lifts the cruel cross. Lone and friendless now, he climbs towards the hill. We worship at your feet, where wrath and mercy meet, and the guilty world is washed by love's pure stream. For us he was made sin, oh help me. Father, forgive. Tears comes our joy, from your death our life shall spring. By your resurrection power we shall rise. We worship at your feet, where wrath and mercy meet, and the guilty world by love's pure stream. For us he was missing, oh help me take it in. Deep wounds of love cry out, Father forgive. I worship, I worship the Lamb who was slain.
Good morning, everybody. I'm now going to read the book of Mark, chapter 15, verses 1 to 20. Very early in the morning, the chief priests the elders, the teachers of the law, and the whole Sanhedrin made their plans. So they bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. "Are you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate. "You have said so," Jesus replied. Excuse me. The chief priests accused him of many things. So again, Pilate asked him, "Aren't you going to answer? See how many things they are accusing you of." But Jesus still made no reply, and Pilate was amazed. Now it was the custom at the festival to release a prisoner whom the people requested. A man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder in the uprising. The crowd came up and asked Pilate to do for them what he usually did. "Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate, knowing it was out of self-interest that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to get Pilate to release Barabbas instead. "What shall I do then with the one you call the king of the Jews?" Pilate asked them. "Crucify him," they shouted. "Why, what crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led Jesus away into the place, that is the praetorium, and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" Again and again, they struck him on the head with a staff and spat on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. Amen.
The Son of God, given.
this love of Christ shall flow like rivers. Come wash, wash your guilt away.
Our next reading is Mark chapter 15 and starting at verse 21. A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it, and they crucified him. Dividing up his clothes, they cast lots to see what each would get. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Christ, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. At the sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. At the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." One man ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a stick, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus heard his cry and saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Some women were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James the younger, and of Joseph and Salmon. In Galilee, these women had followed him and cared for his needs. Many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem were also there. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all and all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands at victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his. Bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. And no power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. And no power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Well, hello, everyone. What I want to do this morning is go through that passage that we've been hearing from Mark's Gospel, but with the lens of three titles that are given about Jesus. And as we go through, I also want to do two other things. I want to just give us the timeline of what's been happening on Good Friday, when the things are happening. And also, we'll see the fulfillment of the predictions that Jesus gave as we go along. And through that, and through the lens of the three titles, we'll see the meaning and significance of why Friday was indeed a good Friday. To remind you, Jesus predicted, Mark 10:33, we're going up to Jerusalem, he said, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock and spit on him, flog him and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise. So the first is that the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. And we're about 3 a.m. on Good Friday morning, and Jesus is betrayed by Judas and then taken to the Sanhedrin, as we have in chapter 15, is it 14, sorry, verse 53, they took Jesus to the high priests, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the teachers of the law came together for this mock trial. Meanwhile, Peter is outside. And Jesus has various accusations made against him, none of which agree, none of which stick. But then, verse 60, the high priest asked him, that's Jesus, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" "I am," said Jesus, "and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." Our first title there, Jesus himself says, "I'm the Son of Man." The Son of Man who will sit at the right hand of the Mighty One and come on the clouds of heaven. The Son of Man speaks of his suffering, yes, but also speaks that he will be the supreme king over all, winning victory for his people. And he's quoting there Jesus, Daniel 7, verses 13 and 14. "Hear them." This is when victory is given to the persecuted people of God. "In my vision, I looked, and there before me was one like a Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven." That's the words Jesus is using. "He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed." So here we have actually the clearest statement that Jesus makes this whole time before the resurrection of who he truly is. He is God's king, the supreme king, and he is one who will reign, and he will bring the kingdom of God with power. Remember, he'd said to people time after time, "Don't tell them about this. Don't tell that when Jesus is acknowledged by Peter as the Messiah. Don't tell people." But now it's been plain. It was plain when he rode into Jerusalem on the donkey. He was the King of Peace. Now it's plain he is the Son of Man who will reign and rule and save. He will bring many converts to him, a new community, and ultimately the new creation. And he saw that ahead, and for the joy that was set before him, he endured the shame, the pain, the cross, the suffering. But then what was the chief priests, the teachers of the law, reaction to this statement of Jesus? Verse 63, the high priest tore his clothes. "Why do we need any more witnesses?" he asked. "You've heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" They all condemned him as worthy of death. Jesus predicted the chief priests and teachers of the law will condemn him to death. Then we move on to chapter 15, verse 1, and we're about 5 a.m. in the morning. And Jesus predicted they, the chief priests, teachers of the law, will hand Jesus over to the Gentiles. Chapter 15, verse 1, very early in the morning, the chief priests with the elders, the teachers of the law, and the whole Sanhedrin made their plans. So they bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. And then we get our next title. As Pilate says, "Are you the king of the Jews? You have said so," Jesus replied. And then we move on to verse 12. And actually, Jesus is taken to Herod and brought back Herod Antipas. So we're now about 6 a.m. in the morning. And we're at verse 12. where Pilate says, "What shall I do then with the one you call the King of the Jews?" Pilate asked them. "Crucify him," they shouted. "Why, what crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." And Pilate hands him over to be crucified. What does the title King of the Jews speak of? It speaks that how God will become king through his son Jesus will be the path of suffering, the crucified king, the suffering king. And then as Pilate hands him over to be crucified, verse 15, he has him flogged, Jesus predicted. They handed Jesus over to the Gentiles, who will flog him. And then we have that the Gentiles will mock and spit on him, Jesus predicted. As verses 16 through 18, they put him mockingly in this purple robe signifying royalty. They twisted a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews," again and again. They struck him on the head with a staff and spat on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. Mockery. Cruel, cruel mockery with a crown of thorns. He's the suffering king. And then we move to the third hour of verse 25, 9 a.m. in the morning, and they crucify him. And what's the notice above Jesus? The King of the Jews. But his mocking and suffering is not yet over, because the Jewish people then mock him there. Verse 31. 32, "And he saved others," they said, "but he cannot save himself. Let this Messiah, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. Oh, how he suffered. The King of the Jews, suffering. But in suffering, he suffers for us, doesn't he? As Isaiah puts it, he was a man of sorrows, familiar with grief. And it was in pain and suffering. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, as he was pierced then for our transgressions. Or as the hymn writer puts it, and we say in devotion, "See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. When did such love and sorrow meet? Or thorns compose so rich a crown?" Then we move to midday, to 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the sixth hour to the ninth hour, verse 33. "At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' Later, he has a loud cry. He breathes his last, and the curtain of the temple is torn open." But then we get our third title at 3 in the afternoon. That battle-hardened soldier says, when he saw how Jesus died and heard his cry, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Jesus is the Son of Man, the supreme king who will rule and save. Jesus is the King of the Jews who will suffer for us and in our place. And he's also the Son of God who will save us. He saved us by entering into that darkness, abandoned under the wrath of God for those hours there, forsaken so that we would not be forsaken. The punishment that brought us peace was laid on Jesus. And then as he breathed his last, as the other gospel, John tells us, he cried out, "It is finished, it's done, it's complete." He was killed, as he predicted. And the temple curtain is torn open, saying to us, through Jesus is the way to our Heavenly Father. We can have peace with God through him. And we acknowledge him like the soldier, as the Son of God. It's telling in Mark's gospel, Son of God is at the beginning of the gospel, where Mark says, the beginning of the good news, the gospel about Jesus, the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God. Demons say he's the Son of God, but now the first time a human, Jesus' ministry, says He's the Son of God. He worships him as the Savior, as Messiah, as King, the Supreme King, the Suffering King, the Saving King. He adores him by saying he's the Son of God. And in our hearts, let's do the same. Let's adore and worship our Lord. And let us respond in the words of the hymn, "Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my life, my soul, my all." But then, between 3 and 6, in the afternoon on that Good Friday, Jesus is buried, laid in that cold stone tomb. But that's not the last word, is it? We have one more prediction, which we will obviously come to on Easter Sunday. 3 days later, he will rise. Let's now prepare in our hearts for the Lord's Supper, for communion, and as we sing the song, "Oh, to see the dawn, the power of the cross."
Day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten, then nailed to a cross of wood. Oh, to see the pain written on your
we're going to come to a time of communion now. So if you have your bread and your cup, then please do have it readily to hand. We have heard various passages from the book of Mark. And as we lead into a time of communion, I'm going to again read from Mark's Gospel and chapter 14, starting at verse 22. It's when Jesus and his disciples, on that Thursday evening, as we think of it, were in the upper room. They had shared fellowship with each other. They then shared a meal. And as part of that, Jesus then said this to them. While they were eating, Jesus took the bread. He gave thanks and broke it, and he said, "Take it, this is my body." And then he took the cup, gave thanks and offered it to them and said, "Drink from it. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. "I tell you the truth, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God." We're going to come and we're going to think of both his body and his blood shed for us. So let me pray. I'll pray for both elements and then I'll guide us through taking the bread and the wine. But let me just pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are able to remember your death. We don't thank you in one sense for the fact that you died, because we know that you didn't deserve to die. And yet we do come with utmost thanks, because only because of your death are we able to then come together. Are we able to not just come together as a group of people, but ultimately we're able to come as individuals before your throne, to have that confidence, to be able to know that because you took the punishment that we rightly had, we are able to have that relationship restored with you. As we think about your body, as we've read already, broken so cruelly and viciously on that cross, Father God, help us to remember that you did that willingly, lovingly for us. And as we take the cup and we remember your blood spilt, again, Father, we think of that sacrifice, that perfect Lamb of God, the sacrifice to end all sacrifices, that blood shed to wash us clean. Help us to remember as we take the bread and the cup. Amen. So Jesus took the bread. He broke it. And whilst we can't give it to each of us, we take the bread and let's eat it together, remembering Christ's body broken for us. And then the passage says, he took the cup and he said, "Drink it, all of you. My blood of the new covenant. Let's drink together, remembering Christ's blood shed for each of us." Almighty God, only because you were willing to come down to earth can we then look heavenwards with confidence because of what Jesus did by dying on the cross and taking our punishment. Help us to reflect. Help us to remember. Help us to rejoice as we look towards Easter Sunday, to be reminded of your resurrection. Amen. Roger is going to pray now for us, and or not for us, well, he might pray for us, I don't know. Roger is going to pray, and then we're going to sing another song as we work towards the end of our service. We're going to sing after Roger's prayed, "Oh, Praise the Name." So, Roger, over to you, please, to continue this time of prayer and reflection.
Hello, everybody. Shall we bow our heads in prayer this Good Friday morning? We may not know, we cannot tell what pain he had to bear, but we believe it was for us. He hung and suffered there. Dear Heavenly Father, on this most good Friday, help us to take on board the enormity of what you did for mankind those 2021 years ago. Father, you sent your Son to this earth to bring us hope and salvation when we deserve none of it. In fact, Father God, we deserve quite the opposite. And sadly, we still do. Help us today consider this event in history afresh. May we realise, in fact, it is and was the most important day in history that ever was. Thank you, Jesus, for your obedience to your Father's bidding. Thank you, Jesus, for bearing the agony you felt in the Garden of Gethsemane. Thank you for forgoing the false trial and the dreadful sentence you were handed by sinful man. Thank you, Lord, for that dreadful journey you took to the cross. All that shame, all that pain, all that suffering, all that mockery, all for us. Thank you, Lord, for the cross. Thank you, Lord, for the compassion on the cross you showed to us. Thank you, Lord, for dying on that cruel cross for us. Thank you, Lord, for the curtain being torn in two to restore our access to you, our holy God. And thank you, Lord, for the empty tomb 3 days later. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Please, can you quietly, in your own hearts, pray out thanks to the Lord for what was done that day. Heavenly Father, we pray for the world at this Easter time, a world that is far, far from perfect, a world where we see war and we see famine, where we see oppression and we see injustice. We see dreadful persecution, even dreadful persecution to your own people. We see a world still ravaged by COVID, and even our friends across the water, Lord, have gone into a third lockdown this week. Heavenly Father, we pray for the world. Each of us has our own country that we may be praying for and situation that we may be praying for. So why don't you quietly pray for something in the world that's troubling you right now? Heavenly Father, thank you for the improving COVID situation in the UK. Thank you, Lord, that the numbers of deaths from this dreadful virus is continuing to fall, and that those now vaccinated number over 30 million. Thank you, Father, for all the heroes in this land who have helped make us be where we are today. Heavenly Father, we saw a glimpse of normality returning this week. What a joy for many to see friends, family, and loved ones for the first time in ages. The hope for the future this brings. Perhaps a small foretaste of what it will be like when the Lord returns. We pray, Father, that maybe this time, this Easter time, that folk consider what they have been through there in recent times, and they turn to you at this time. O Lord, may this be so. Please, can you pray your prayers for the UK at this time, Simon? Finally, Father, we pray and lift up our fellowship to you. Thank you for the angel lambing event on Monday. What a joy it was to hand out those parcels of lamb and other things too, to the children and the parents alike. Thank you, Lord, for all those that were involved and all those that helped. We also pray that many will follow the lost sheep trail and also attend our services, especially the U event, Easter for You event next Sunday. Heavenly Father, we pray for our Easter service, Easter Sunday service in a couple of days' time. We have the joy, Lord, of returning to our church building for the first time. Heavenly Father, please be with that event. Thank you, Lord, that it is now fully booked. And thank you, Father, that people have shown a willingness to be there. We pray, Lord, that it goes smoothly and well. And those that watch on YouTube and those that watch it live will be truly blessed this Easter day. Heavenly Father, many of our fellowship have suffered in recent times. Please comfort them right now. We particularly lift up Helen to you as she is visiting her grandma Aileen this very day. It will put, her grandma is in the last of the days of her life, and we pray, Lord, that Helen can be comforted by you, and so can all the family. There are many more in our fellowship too, in similar situations. Heavenly Father, this is a difficult time for Coley Park Baptist Church. And we ask you for guidance, for wisdom, for patience, for care, for boldness, for unity, for compassion, for perseverance, for growth, and for so much more. Please can you silently pray for whatever is on your heart with regard to our church. There was no other good enough to pay the price of sin. He only could unlock the gate and let us in. Amen.
Amen.
Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bowed and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the
Gospel tells us that after the disciples and Jesus had that first communion, They sang a hymn, just as we've done there, and then they went out to the Mount of Olives. But they hadn't got the traditions of church, had they? So before we go out to our Mount of Olives, we're going to have some notices. Not going to have many, but just a couple. In a moment, I'm going to close in prayer, and then we can stay on this Zoom and the church family can have a fellowship together, a conversation together. So please do stay on if you're able to. And then a reminder that on Sunday, we have our Easter Day service when we rejoice and we celebrate Jesus' resurrection. So please do join us. As Roger's mentioned, there are a number of us who are going to be celebrating back in the building, and it will be a different scenario for many of us, but we look forward to that. It is fully booked, as Roger said, so please don't try and book in for that. But it is going to be live on YouTube. So again, please do log on to YouTube and see the event or the event, the service that we have on Easter Sunday morning. Let me close in prayer together as we go our separate ways. Father God, we celebrate today, and that is odd on the basis that we celebrate a death. And yet we celebrate because of what that death means for us and for humanity. That the Son of God, God himself, having come down to earth as a human, died a human death. But that death was so far from human, on the basis that you took the weight of humanity on yourself in our wrongdoing. Father God, help us to reflect and help us to respond with awe and reverence and thanksgiving that you are willing to die in order that you would, and you have, been risen from the dead to enable us to come confidently and boldly before your throne forevermore. Help us remember that as we reflect on this Good Friday. Amen.